Good afternoon. Thank you for waiting. We were trying to gather everybody here. It's a little bit difficult, but we will start. I will present you to Daniele Viotti. He's Italian and he comes from the European Parliament. And José Sueiro. It's a Portuguese parliament and a member of Left Bloc. In a couple of minutes, Catarina Marcelino, the Secretary of State for Citizenship and Equality in Portugal, will be joining us. So, thank you for being here with us until now, and we will start. Daniele, it's for you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, and first of all, congratulations for your conference. I read the program. It's a very intensive program. Congratulations very much. I'm sorry, I won't speak in English because my English is not very good. So I think it's better for you if I speak in Italian and Tatiana helped me to translate. So now I start in Italian. Farò qualche considerazione molto breve sul rispondendo alle domande per cui sono stato invitato qua. La prima domanda è una brevissima introduzione, spiegazione su cosa sta succedendo nel nostro paese, in Italia, rispetto alla questione dei diritti civili in generale, del riconoscimento delle coppie formate da persone dello stesso sesso e della genitorialità.
He will start answering some questions that have to do with our conference, and so he will talk about what's happening in Italy as regards civil rights in general, same-sex couples and how they are recognized by law, and parenting.
Il percorso, come forse sapete, è stato un percorso accidentato e che si è, dal mio punto di vista, non concluso, ma è iniziato lo scorso anno, intorno a maggio, con la prima legge in Italia sulle unioni civili. Una legge che riconosce il diritto di due persone dello stesso sesso di unirsi civilmente presso un municipio, ma che non riconosce tutta un'altra serie di diritti, più importante del quale la mancanza più grande che ha questa legge è la cosiddetta riconoscimento della stepchild adoption. Per cui per approvare questa legge in un Parlamento che è formato da una maggioranza politica che è formata da forze di centrodestra e forze di centrosinistra, si è dovuto rinunciare a un pezzo importantissimo, dal mio punto di vista, la parte più importante in assoluto della legge, di quello che veniva richiesto al movimento LGBTI italiano.
So about the civil union issue, it was a long and very difficult path, and which is not didn't reach its end in Daniele Viotti's opinion. It only started last year when in May the civil union law for same-sex couple was approved. And this law recognized many rights, obviously the right to for two people of the same sex to get a civil union, which is not married, but what other rights are not there, are not in the law, and the biggest lack is that is the one I also talked about yesterday, stepchild adoption. It was part of the bill, as I said, but it didn't become law. It's not in the law because there are obviously in the parliament different. There are left wing side and the right wing side, and to they reach this compromise of not letting stepchild adoption pass.
Italia è circondata, lo dico spesso, da paesi che hanno legislazioni molto più avanzate della nostra, penso al Portogallo che ci ospita, penso alla Spagna, alla Francia e altri paesi che, europei. Però io ho una considerazione che vorrei condividere con voi, ed è il fatto che una speranza innanzitutto, ma anche un'idea che mi sto facendo, per cui quello che noi abbiamo conquistato oggi, quello che al punto in cui si è arrivati, non si tornerà più indietro, e quello che si potrà fare sarà soltanto di più. Ve lo dico, guardate, perché se voi fate caso a quello che sta succedendo in molti paesi nel mondo, ci accorgiamo che il tema, per esempio, del riconoscimento dei diritti civili per le persone LGBTI non è più un tema che differenzia i partiti di destra dai partiti di sinistra. Il tema dei diritti delle persone LGBTI è un tema che divide trasversalmente agli schieramenti politici, divide i progressisti dai conservatori. E purtroppo si trovano conservatori anche nei partiti di sinistra, si trovano progressisti anche nei partiti di destra. Vi faccio tre esempi. Il primo è il Regno Unito, l'Inghilterra. Voi sapete che in Inghilterra il matrimonio egualitario è stato introdotto da un leader conservatore, David Cameron, peraltro che sarà ricordato come uno dei peggiori leader europei dopo la questione della Brexit. Però fu introdotto da David Cameron e furono significative le sue parole, perché lui disse: io non sono contrario al matrimonio egualitario in quanto conservatore, ma sono a favore del matrimonio egualitario proprio perché conservatore, e la famiglia per me è un elemento di stabilità della società. Gli altri due esempi sono di una campagna elettorale appena conclusa e una che è nel vivo adesso. La prima è quella americana, dove uno dei peggiori candidati, poi diventato presidente, sto scrivendo opinioni naturalmente, uno dei peggiori candidati, poi diventato presidente, Donald Trump, ha per mesi detto, e adesso sta facendo, di tutto sui diritti civili. Ha parlato contro le donne, contro gli immigrati, sappiamo cosa ha detto e cosa sta facendo. Ma quando è stato intervistato più volte sul tema del matrimonio egualitario introdotto dalla sentenza dell'8 giugno 2014, ha detto: quel che è fatto e non si torna più indietro. In Francia invece, se voi osservate la campagna elettorale di Marine Le Pen, vi accorgerete che Marine Le Pen dice le peggio cose, delle cose orrende, orribili, non ultima sugli ebrei qualche giorno fa, sui musulmani, sulla chiusura delle frontiere, contro gli immigrati, ma non spende una sola parola sui diritti civili conquistati in Francia, dove il matrimonio egualitario è stato introdotto ormai da alcuni anni, perché quei diritti sono stati acquisiti e sono entrati nella cultura generale dei paesi. Per cui, chiudo, scusami per la lunghezza, per cui proprio l'altro giorno mi hanno intervistato a una radio e mi chiedevano cosa succederà nel 2018 quando in Italia ci saranno le elezioni. E io ho detto che secondo me, se vincerà uno schieramento progressista, e oggi in Italia purtroppo ricalchiamo ancora invece il vecchio schema, uno schieramento progressista di sinistra e di centrosinistra, potremo avere più di quello che abbiamo oggi, cioè la step child adoption e il matrimonio egualitario vero e proprio. Ma se vinceranno le forze più retrograde e più conservatrici italiane, la Lega Nord, i partiti di destra, eccetera, sicuramente non torneremo indietro su quanto è stato conquistato.
He says Italy is surrounded by countries with more advanced laws as regards civil rights for LGBTI people, like Portugal, Spain, France, etc. But he has a hope, and his idea is what we reach until now. We can go back, we can only advance. So the civil rights we have now, they are like acquired, and we can go back anymore. And he used three examples from what is happening in the world. about the only issue of civil rights for LGBTI people. He says they already they don't split left wings and right wings, but they differentiate, they split conservatives and progressive political forces. For example, in UK, equal marriage for same-sex people passed with David Cameron, who is a conservative. And David Cameron said he is fine with equal marriage because he is conservative, because he is for people, he is for marriage for people. So then in the USA, Donald Trump, we all of us know what he's been saying until now, what he's doing as a president about against women's rights, migrants, etc. But when he was asked about equal marriage, he said that what is done and we can't go back anymore. And in France, Marine Le Pen also, very racist, and she's been saying horrible things recently also against Hebrews, migrants, Muslims. But she never talked against the civil rights for LGBTI people. And what Daniele Vidotti is saying is that civil rights for same-sex people, i.e. For LGBTI people, are already a part of the general and shared culture in this country. So he's been asked, he was asked about the next elections, political elections in Italy, and he said that if in Italy left wing and more progressive forces will win, we will probably have stepchild adoption and equal marriage for same-sex couples recognized. If the most conservative and right-wing forces will win, we probably won't have this, but anyway, we will not go back to what we had before.
Le ultime due brevissime considerazioni sono su di noi come comunità LGBTI. Perché io sento su di me una responsabilità enorme. Io credo e vedo in tutta Europa che il movimento LGBTI è l'unico oggi movimento veramente organizzato per i diritti civili. Molto più organizzato di quanto non siano le donne, per esempio, che invece lo erano molto nel passato, molto più organizzato di quanto non siano le organizzazioni per i diritti dei migranti. Quindi noi abbiamo due responsabilità: tenere insieme e fare dei passi avanti. Tenere insieme, noi non dobbiamo mai dimenticarci, quando parliamo dei nostri diritti e facciamo le nostre battaglie e facciamo i nostri dibattiti, i nostri approfondimenti, non dobbiamo mai dimenticarci che abbiamo la responsabilità di tenere con noi anche quelle parti di comunità che oggi vedono ancora sotto attacco i loro diritti, a partire dalle donne, arrivare ai migranti, arrivare alle comunità rom, ai giovani diseredati. Quindi noi abbiamo una responsabilità molto grande, secondo me, e non possiamo pensare che le nostre battaglie siano battaglie soltanto per la nostra comunità. La seconda è quella di far progredire sempre di più il dibattito. E allora io so che qui in Portogallo, ma in tutta Europa, nel mio paese, in Italia, ogni volta che parliamo di genitorialità c'è un attacco sfrenato da parte dei più conservatori nei nostri confronti. Allora io credo che voi facciate bene non soltanto a organizzare, noi, voi soprattutto, e ripeto i complimenti, non soltanto a organizzare iniziative come queste in cui non si risponde alle provocazioni, ma si porta più in là l'asticella e si approfondisce ancora di più e si porta ancora più in là. E allora tutti i dibattiti che avete fatto, io sono andato a vedermi, sono gli incontri, i seminari che avete fatto, sono seminari e incontri che portano più in là l'asticella e non guardano e non rispondono alle polemiche dei giornali e non rispondono alle polemiche dei più conservatori. E ancora di più lo scorso anno, quando avete fatto la prima edizione in cui parlavate delle relazioni non monogamiche, e io penso che quello sia il futuro del dibattito, Credo che abbiate dato un contributo fondamentale, quindi quello che ci spetta come compito è quello di tenere insieme e quello di fare dei passi da gigante.
So the last two points about our community, LGBTI community. He is a huge responsibility. He thinks that the LGBTI movement in Europe is the only movement, or is the movement best organized about the fight for civil rights today, in this moment, more than, for example, women movement, who was, in his opinion, more organized once, and more than organization for the rights of migrant people. And so we, all of us as a community, have the responsibility to keep with us all the communities that that don't have their rights recognized. So we cannot fight for our civil rights without taking into account all the rights that are not recognized for other communities. And about the issue of parenting, he says that we are about this issue, we are under a huge attack in this moment, and he said that it's very, very important what these events like this one we are organizing and other realities are organizing, because what we are doing is not simply going on with these fights, with these wars that are happening in the media and in the debate in Europe and in Italy, but we are taking these issues and discussing about this issue. We are going simply, we are deepen the questions and are going beyond, and I'm not simply taking these fights that are not productive. And also because he is he took a look on all the things that Intimate organized. So he was talking about our last conference, and for example when we talked about also the question of non-monogamies. And he says only this, also this issue is very important, and he thinks it's one of the issues that are going to be more and more important and be discussed in the future. And this is also another cool thing that we did, and he's very happy about it, and he thinks these kind of events are very important in general.
Thank you, Daniele. I will now ask Sueiro.
Boa tarde. Hello. Good afternoon. I will speak in English, so please apologize if not all the terms will be so correct. If you don't understand, please raise your hand and someone will try to translate. First of all, I want to thank the invitation and to congratulate you for the all the project and for this conference in particular. I will not repeat the importance of the legal achievements and the growing visibility of LGBTI issues in Portugal. We are proud of it, but we are not satisfied. So I will focus in what I will talk with you. I will focus on what we still have to do, on what we still have to discuss, and on the limitations of the present situation and the need to go further. And I will do it focusing mainly in three dimensions of it, of the path that we have to do. The first is we had very important legal achievements, but we know that law is not enough. The second dimension of it is that even when the law is ahead in terms of rights, it's always late in terms of the recognition of the multiple dimensions of the living practices that we have. And the third is because there is no justice only with symbolic and legal recognition. So there's no justice without putting together this legal and symbolic recognition with the redistribution of socioeconomic resources. And this is valid for LGBTI issues and for queer partnering, I think. So going to my first point, we had important legal achievements. We included discrimination based on sexual orientation and gender identity in our laws, in some of our laws, in the constitution of our republic. The question of sexual orientation is there, but it's not the gender identity reference. We have in the penal code some reference to this issue. We had the same-sex cohabitation law in 2000, we had the same-sex marriage law in 2010, we had in 2016 the adoption, and we had a law about the access to art. But law is not enough for many reasons. The first reason is that, in what concerns to discrimination, for example, is that if people don't know the law and their rights, the law cannot be exerted, cannot be put in practice. And it is true that according to the data, the European data about Portugal, the majority of people wouldn't know what they should do if they are victim of discrimination. So if there is no information, if there's no awareness, if there's no education, if you want, the law is not effective. Secondly, because the access to law and to the legal system is also very limited. I mean, how many condemnations there were in Portugal for homophobic or transphobic discrimination, even if it is in the law? How much people have to pay to accede to the court, to accede to legal procedures? What tools have the associations to use the law in their struggle, in their daily life? Also, law is not enough because the details of law regulation are often where, using a Portuguese, I think it's a Portuguese expression, are usually where the devil is hidden. I mean, we have an important law about the access to art, to assisted reproductive techniques, I think it's, that opened the access in a limited way that I will talk later, to women and to LGBTI couples. But if there are not, if there is not a public service, for example, of sperm banks, I don't know if it is the word in English, the law cannot be effective. If there is a huge waiting list, if we don't have public services that assure that the people can access to this right, we will have limitations that will distinguish people in their access to this, because they can go to the private, but not everybody has the money to go to the private. And also, we are discussing in the regulation, for example, and this is something that we must be aware, if, for example, if there is a waiting list, if heterosexual couples or couples should have priority, for example, to women that are alone. Or the law doesn't have an age limit, but the law regulation can have, we'll see, but we fear that they can put an age limit in the law regulation. So there is these limitations. And then there is the question of institutions. The law is also applied by institutions, and we must change also institutions. I mean, in terms of training, of awareness of the people that work in schools, in the national health system, in the security system, and so on. We must, at the same time that we have legal achievements, we must work on public policies that also focus these dimensions. So this was the first point, that law is not enough. Secondly, the law, even when it is progressive, I'm talking about the law because as I'm working in the parliament, I thought it could be useful to address these questions. So even when the law is progressive, it's often backwards in relation to the diversity of practice. And in our case, I think there is still much to do to assure that the law gets rid of some prejudices, of patronizing conceptions, of male guardianship, or of specialist guardianship that often block a real and a full autonomy and respect for the self-determination of people. I will give you three examples. We had in 2011 a very important law that recognized the right of trans people to change their name in the civil in the civil documents. It was a very important law because it took away this process from the courts, and it didn't demand any condition related to surgeries or to... it recognized people that made their change in foreign countries and so on. But this law that was very important, I have a link to this law because I was very engaged in its writing, but it has a terrible limitation, is that it demands a diagnosis of mental disability, a diagnosis of gender perturbation. Gender dysphoria. So, it recognizes a right, but it recognizes a right from a condition of sickness, and not from a condition of citizenship, and of respect for self-determination. We have now, Left Bloc presented a law proposition that is now in the Parliament. The government announced that it will present also a law proposition, so we must change, and it's time to change this. But also about, for example, surrogacy. We had in 2016 a discussion of the new law of assisted reproductive techniques that opened the access to every woman. So to women that are alone, I don't know if this is, I don't like this term in fact, but to women that single, and to same-sex couples. So it was important because it took away from the access to art, the man guardianship, and even the idea of couple. We can have the access to these techniques even if we are not in a couple, and without the presence of a man. But one of these techniques, that is the surrogacy, I learned this 10 minutes with Ana Cristina. The access to surrogacy is dependent on a condition of infertility, and it's not an option that is an option of every woman. And even in the regulation of the access to this particular technique, there are frightening propositions. For example, the idea that the women that gestantes, como é que se diz? That are the gestants? Gestational carrier. They would have to have had kids before. It is a proposition that is now on the table. And the right wing, that was never concerned with the identity of the sperm donors when there was a heterosexual couple, now they say if there is a woman, a single woman, or a couple of lesbian, we must assure the right of the children to know who is his father. We are talking about sperms, and they call it father in the discussion. So it's absurd, but it's a proof of the that there are still many patriarchal ideas that are strong, that have a strong expression in the public debate. Also, in the same-sex cohabitation law, that it was very important, but it's true, and I think that your project will help us to rethink this. It's true that it has a base. It is based on the idea of monogamous arrangements, of living in the same house. Even the marriage demands living in the same house, in the law. And it ignores the multiple forms of friendship, or sexualized friendship, or the term you want to use. I don't know if these are the most correct. And this happened, I would say, because the achievements of the social movement, also in the LGBTI movement, they combined an affirmative action with a normativization effect. I mean, they affirmed rights, and at the same time they affirmed rights in the law, they reaffirmed normative conceptions of couple, of family, of sexual identity. And I think it's time to think of laws that are transformative also in this way, so that ally recognition to a destabilization and blurring of these distinctions between man and woman, gay, straight, and even of the conceptions of couple and family. And also, for example, last example, the people with functional diversity. We are discussing right now, it was included in the budget, state budget this year, a project for independent life. It is a strong struggle, the recognition of the functional diversity, people with functional diversity or people with disability. It is a strong struggle to recognize their autonomy and not to link their rights to institutions and to institutions that guard them. And I will finish with this idea. It's 2 minutes. With this, the last idea is that the struggle for legal recognition and symbolic recognition must be linked to the struggle for redistribution, using the Nancy Fraser's terms, or socio-economic redistribution. Because if we don't have an integrated strategy, we will not achieve and we will not consider the multiple dimensions of justice and of equality. And I'm talking in a country that was that lived a traumatic experience of austerity policies and of foreign intervention, of IMF and the European Central Bank, European Union. And we know that austerity meant impoverishment. It meant a huge transfer of wealth from working class people to companies and to the financial system. And it meant also all these forms of raising of discrimination, racism. We have also the refugee crisis that I think it's also must be also thought. And to give an example, can we think about emancipation of LGBTI people without thinking, for example, in the problem of precariousness, of labor precariousness? Precariousness is at the same time the impossibility to plan your life, is a strategy for salary compression, it's a lack of social protection, but it's also a huge, a strong, a very effective strategy of domination by fear. Precariousness of labor, or labor precarity, is a strategy to disseminate economic insecurity as a mean of domination by fear. And this means that the populations that are that suffer other discriminations besides the exploitation in labor, in the labor places and in their life, they have less conditions to talk, to demand their rights, to affirm who they are, to assume their identities, to live their life, to emancipate, to have access to housing and so on. And if we talk about housing, and I'll finish this with this because today was the deliver of in the United Nations of a report on housing that has a dimension about Portugal, and this report says that in Portugal almost 60% of the 58% of the young people till 30 years, they are still living in their parents' house. Can we have queering partnership or queer parenting and whatever if we have this housing situation? The gentrification of cities is also a matter that is related with the LGBTI struggles, because if we don't have an autonomous space to live our sexuality, to live our life, to live our friendship, we have less conditions to have to exercise our own choices. So, in fact, I think we must also think in these questions in an intersectional way, and also putting together all these dimensions of recognition, redistribution, economic struggle, symbolic struggle, and all this together. Thank you very much.
Thank you, José. I will now leave you with Catarina Marcelino, Portuguese Secretary of State for Citizenship and Equality.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon to all. I'm very glad to share the floor with Daniel Viotti. We were together last week in Malta, speaking about the same issue. To be here with José Soeiro, he's my colleague in the parliament. When the time when I was deputy last 2 years ago or something, and with Luciana Moreira, thank you for sharing this table. And I want to say Ana Cristina that I'm very grateful to the invitation to participate in this conference and for the chance to share the Portuguese government strategy and vision in the area of LGBTI rights in such a challenging platform. Thank you for the invitation. This project is fundamental to understand the shifts that are taking place in our societies. However, this project also demonstrates that more than often, our societal structures fail to respond to such shifts, that the reaction is slow and limited. In this connection, I will take a broader approach to my intervention. Portugal has lived crucial changes, and not only in the area of parenting rights for LGBTI people. Although admittedly still limited, it is my conviction that Portugal has opened unique paths for transformation. My purpose is to give a more systematic view on how Portugal has challenged heteronormativity through the principle of equality and non-discrimination, and through more inclusive public policies. Over the past two decades, we have made significant achievements in combating discrimination based on sexual orientation and gender identity. These have a strong impact on the personal relationships and relational well-being that this project analyzes. José Soeiro told before, but allow me to highlight some milestones achieved in the last 15 years, because I think it's important. It's not just Malta who are doing things now. We have 15 years of history in this field, and I think it's important to highlight the most important moments. In 2004, our constitution introduced sexual orientation as a prohibited discrimination ground, thus opening way for many of the following legislative changes. In 2010, same-sex couples were given the right to marry. In 2011, the procedure for sex and first name change in the civil registry was created. Since then, 375 people have undergone this change, 109 of which were young people and aged between 18 and 24, and these numbers are very, very important. In 2013, our criminal law added gender identity discrimination as an aggravating factor and gender identity as a protected ground under the crime of discrimination. In 2016, Portugal undertook two fundamental changes in the fight against discrimination on the basis of sexual orientation, particularly in the area of parenting. Adoption was extended to same-sex couples, and access to medically assisted procreation was extended to all women, regardless of infertility diagnosis, marital status, or sexual orientation. Further, the legislative changes, other steps have have been taken. And José spoke about the need to have what not just legislation, but other kind of action, and I agree completely. And some steps we did yet. There has been an effort to better prepare professionals with regards to the needs of LGBTI groups, chiefly within the National Health Service, and we need to do more. Last December, in partnership with NGOs, we opened 3 support centers for LGBTI victims of violence, one of which specifically for young persons. These provide legal and psychological support. This is completely new in Portugal. The National Health Service provides access to surgical procedures and or pharmacological treatments. However, there is still a long way to go to improve access of trans persons to these treatments. As per recommendations of the General Inspectorate for Health Activities, and we need to think about what we can do to improve the surgical procedures in our medical system. Notwithstanding what has already been done, the Portuguese government is clearly committed to advancing LGBTI rights, and this is expressly stated in its program. A study on the gender identity law prepared in 2016 by a Portuguese university, ISCTE, together with ILGA Portugal and the Norwegian LGBT Association and financed by e-grants, proposes legal improvements in this context. One of the most relevant points relates to the existing requirement of a gender identity disorder diagnosis. José spoke about this. This requirement formally results in leaving the final decision to health professionals. Practices vary greatly, and there are difficulties in assessing medical reports. In 2013, the American Psychiatric Association replaced this gender identity disorder diagnosis with a new diagnosis of gender dysphoria. In this connection, our work with NGOs representing LGBTI people and the changes of the last few years have fostered a legislative proposal of the government that establishes the right to self-determination of the gender identity and gender expression, and the right to the protection of the sexual characteristics of each person. This proposal is currently under discussion. It shares many of the central concerns that also underline the legislative proposals that are being prepared by Left Bloc and People, Animals, Nature Party. Among others, these proposals are to clarify the concepts of gender identity, gender expression and sexual characteristics, inspired by pioneering legislation in countries such as Chile, Malta and the Community of Madrid, to uphold the principle of self-determination excluding medical or clinical criteria, in line with countries like Argentina, Denmark, Malta and Ireland, to allow young people between 16 and 18 to request the change of sex in the civil registry through their legal representatives, and this is a very important step, to require the person's express and informed consent for any treatment or intervention involving modifications to the body or sexual characteristics, to establish that in the case of minors, and save for cases where there is a clear risk to their physical health, any such intervention can only be recommended after the minor's gender identity manifests and depending on the express and informed consent of the legal representatives. To implement measures in the education field, education is the key for all these issues, to guarantee that the right to self-determination is upheld in schools, to empower associations and NGOs by giving them procedural rights. We are very confident in the success of this legislative proposal, which will soon be submitted to the Portuguese Parliament. Finally, and linking to the recommendation of the project, I would make reference to the importance of public policies in the education field. The Portuguese government is working on measures to promote citizenship education in schools. The purpose is to develop citizenship competences and knowledge in children and youth, preparing them to become citizens that value and respect, among others, interpersonal relations, diversity, human rights, and non-discrimination. An example is our partnership with the Exego Network, an association of LGBTI youth and supporters. The goal is to carry out awareness-raising action in schools across 40 Portuguese municipalities to eliminate stereotypes and discrimination in schools. This is part of the larger governmental initiative Citizenship Roadmap that is taking place across the entire country until June 2017, which involves local actors and civil society in promoting debate and reflection on citizenship, largely reflecting the objectives and our commitment to the UN 2030 agenda. This is yet another important stage in the promotion of the rights of LGBTI people by working sustainably for an inclusive and equal society. In this connection, it is with great expectation that I look at this project. It will provide unique knowledge in this area, supported on scientific methods and in interdisciplinary approaches. This knowledge is essential to promote reflection, to inform better policies, and to effect change. In a very fundamental way, this project brings visibility to issues that limit basic choices in people's lives, that pose barriers to people's full realization and well-being. We can no longer rest on words. This must be turned into action. This is a step towards progress and development, but above all, towards equality and happiness. Thank you very much.